Today, I'm going to share with you what our Creator has revealed about the 1973 Arab-Israeli War and how this war ties in with World War III that is at hand. The war began on October 6th, on the day that Judaism observed Yahweh's commanded observance of Yom Kippur, or the Day of Atonement that year. The fact that the war began on this day and the year of this war are both of huge significance. In recent videos, the Most High has been revealing more about his Ezekiel chapter 4, Son of Man prophecy. In this prophecy, he told the Son of Man to lie upon your left side and put the iniquity of the house of Israel upon it. You shall lift up their iniquity for the number of days that you lie upon it, because I have given to you the years of their iniquity according to the number of the days. For 390 days you shall lift up the iniquity of the house of Israel. He led me to speak about these 390 days, but he had not shown me the meaning of the 390 years that they represent until now. I knew that something significant happened 390 years after this prophecy began, but I did not know what. The following verses go on to show that this is a prophecy for 430 years. It was 430 years after Abraham left his kin and Yahweh made a covenant with him that the children of Israel dwelled in the land before Yahweh led them out of Egypt through the hand of his servant Moses. The mirror of these 430 years that is found in this prophecy began in August of the year 1583 when Sir Humphrey Gilbert founded the first English colony in North America at the harbor of St. John. I spoke about this in the 430 years in America and the second Exodus video. I'll put a link to this video in the video description box below. 390 years later is the year 1973. This was the year of the Yom Kippur War. This war was 40 years ago from this year, and it was a foreshadow of the coming war. In verse 6 we read, "And when you have finished them, lie again on your right side, and you shall lift up the iniquity of the house of Judah for 40 days. I have given to you each day for a year. Thus you shall make ready for or prepare for the siege of Jerusalem before your face, and your arm will be uncovered. Thus you shall prophesy against them." In the last video that I uploaded, which was called As Lightning Comes from the East, I spoke about how Yahweh has shown me that during these 390 days, when I have lain on my left side during this time, I have faced the east. I want to make a correction to what I spoke in this video. I said that in each of the six locations that Yahweh led my family and I to pitch his camp, he led me to position my tent in a way that when I slept on my left side, I faced the east. I was wrong. It was five locations. It was actually six tents, but five different locations. I just wanted to just point out that correction. Yahweh began the 430 days of this prophecy on the anniversary of my birth, 50 years after I was born. It is on Yom Kippur that the Most High commands us to sound the trumpet of Jubilee every 50th year for the year of Jubilee. This is recorded in Leviticus 25:9. Yahweh showed us that he rose up Moses from the time of his birth for the first Exodus with the event of his mother placing him in the basket and Pharaoh's daughter finding him. Yahweh is showing us through this parallel of the beginning of this 430-day prophecy on the anniversary of my birth that he rose me up from the time of my birth for the second Exodus that is at hand. And there is more to the timing of the beginning of this prophecy. Last year's November 9th was the end of Jeroboam's profaned feast of the eighth month on Yahweh's restored calendar. Yahweh gave Jeroboam 10 tribes of Israel to rule over, and he warned him not to depart from his instructions. Jeroboam did not hearken to his warning. The first 390 days of this prophecy are for these 10 tribes of Israel. The Most High is saying through this parallel that he has raised me up from my birth to speak against the scattered tribes of Israel for your iniquity. And he is emphasizing your profaning his appointed times by changing them with the beginning of this period of time being the end of Jeroboam's profane feast. In lieu of all this, you should marvel that the Most High orchestrated his timeline to begin this prophecy on the 50th anniversary of my birth. But instead, most of you will scoff at it, like you have the rest of the testimony of his word. The Day of Atonement this year on Yahweh's restored calendar was on September 24th on the calendar that Satan gave his children to use. 70 days later will be on December 3rd. December 4th is the beginning of the 40 days of the Most High's instructions for me to lie upon my right side each day for a year. These 40 days are for me to lift up the iniquity of Judah and Benjamin, who remained with Judah, which Yahweh gave the 10 tribes to Jeroboam. December 3rd is the 20th day of the 9th month on Yahweh's restored calendar. It was on the 20th day of the 9th month that Yahweh's word says in Ezra chapter 10, Then all of the men of Judah and Benjamin gathered themselves together unto Jerusalem in 3 days. It was the ninth month, on the 20th day of the month, and all of the people sat in the street of Elohim's house, trembling upon the word of rain. They issued the call to gather in Jerusalem 3 days prior. They were gathering together to make a covenant with Elohim to put away their strange wives. The covenant that this prophecy is referring to is to put away your whoredoms to the Most High. 3 days prior to the 20th day of the ninth month is November 30th. November 30th is 51 days out from the great end of the great and fearful day of Yahweh's wrath. Yahweh has led me to speak in several recent videos that during these 51 days, He is going to send me to you face to face to tell you that you are going to die if you do not turn from your rebellion to Him. He has sent me to you in the prophecy of and in the spirit of Elijah. Yahweh told Elijah to go with the third group of 51 men to tell Ahaziah face to face that he was going to die. Is the rain that this verse is referring to the rain of hailstones from heaven that might be coming in the tail of the comet Isun? Is it the rain of artillery shells that will be coming upon you from those whom Yahweh has empowered to come against you? We will soon see. In the As Lightning Comes from the East video, I spoke about how Yahweh has revealed that when I will be lying on my right side for these 40 days, I will be facing the west. During the 1973 war, Yahweh rose up a coalition of Arab states that was led by Egypt and Syria to come against Israel. Israel was in the east, the physical land of Israel. And again, this war was 390 years after the 430-year prophecy began in St. John. Both fronts prevailed against Israel for the first 3 days of this 19-day conflict. After 3 days, Israel managed to stop Egypt's advancement at the Sinai Peninsula. Syria attacked at the same time into Golan Heights, and they made gains into Israel's territory as well. But after 3 days, Israel was empowered to push them back. Then Israel launched an offensive deep into Syrian territory for 4 days and came to the outskirts of Damascus. If you have been watching these videos, the Most High has been hammering His touching the dead statute with the sprinkling of the water of separation on the third day and 4 days later on the seventh day. None of these parallels are coincidences. The reason why Yahweh put a hook in the jaws of the Arab coalition and raised them up against Israel on the Day of Atonement is because of what the Day of Atonement represents. I'll expand on this in a bit. Yahweh Elohim, the Holy One of Israel, is a warrior, and He will fight for His people. Israel means Elohim rules over. He certainly does not rule over the descendants of Israel who He began to return to the physical land of Israel in 1948. Like with Christianity, those in Judaism choose to give their worship and their service to make-believe images of the Most High. Yet He used those who He returned to the physical nation of Israel to be an example to the scattered tribes of Israel that He will fight for His people if you will return to Him. He did so 6 years earlier in the Six-Day War as well. Since those who returned to Israel call themselves Israel, He fought for them in a small way. He did so in order to show us that He will fight for Israel. Israel was outnumbered during this conflict, yet they prevailed, just like was the case in times past. Yahweh's word tells us that the descendants of Judah are still going to be scattered at the time of His wrath, and this prophecy tells us that they are scattered in the west. In the 4th century AD, Hillel II of the tribe of Judah profaned Yahweh's Sabbaths by fixing them on a day of the week on the pagan Roman calendar. He changed the Most High Sabbath from using the lunar rotations to determine them to the fixed day of Saturday or Saturn's day. Yahweh then scattered the descendants of Judah and the descendants of Benjamin who were still with them at that time into the four corners of the earth along with the rest of Israel. Along the way, the descendants of Dan embraced the traditions of Judaism along with embracing their Saturn's day abomination. And the descendants of Judah and Benjamin were given over to drift into the captivity of the lies of Christianity. And this prophecy shows that they are gathered in the west. Yahweh returned the descendants of Dan to the land of Israel as part of His witness against the rest of Israel's descendants. Yet they are far from living to be found in His favor. They are not even listed by our Messiah in His revelations that were given to the Apostle John as being one of the 12 tribes that are of the Most High's first fruits. The reason why they are not mentioned is because they reject the Most High's only begotten Son altogether. And they will be recompensed for their doing so. And the rest of you will be recompensed for your trampling His shed blood under your feet for using it for license to transgress against His Father. Yahweh is just using them to be an example to the rest of Israel because they call themselves by the name of Israel and they return there. He has shown through them that in a small way that if you will return to him, he will fight for you. If Dan had returned to him in truth, he would have not just fought for them in a small way. If they had, the world would have seen Kihwe's arm. Things like the blasphemous Dome of the Rock that sets in their midst would not still be standing there. And all of the lands that he gave to Israel would have been restored. He raised this coalition up against them on Yom Kippur by design. He does everything by design. The instructions for Yom Kippur with the high priest and the two goats represent the substitution sacrifice that the Most High set up through his only begotten Son. These instructions are spoken about in parts 2 and 3 of the 7th month High Days videos. I'll put a link to these two videos in the video description box below. Not only has Dan profaned much of Yahweh's word and his righteous character that his word testifies to, they have also rejected his only begotten Son. This was even prophesied of in the prophecy that Israel gave to his 12 sons at the time of his death that was for the latter days. I'll read this to you in Genesis chapter 49. The people of Dan will contend with or strive with one of the rods of Israel. Dan will be a serpent against the way and an adder in the path that strikes at the horse's heels so that his rider falls backwards. Earlier in verse 10, Israel prophesied to Judah that a particular rod would not depart from Judah. The rod that he was referring to was our Messiah that came through David's loins. It is Dan that has contention with Yahweh's only begotten Son. The Yom Kippur war beginning on this day was not a coincidence. In verse 7 of his Ezekiel 4 Son of Man prophecy, the Most High tells us that the Son of Man's arm will be uncovered. He does not tell us if this will be at the beginning of these 40 days or at some point during them or at the end of them. Like I pointed out, 3 days before the Ezra prophecy, therefore 4 days before this 40-day period begins, the third group of 51 days begins. These 51 days are the last of the final 153 days before the end of the great and fearful day of his wrath. These last 153 days began on the day that Yahweh gave Ezekiel his chapter 8 prophecy that flows into chapter 9 and his instructions to slay all of you who do not have his mark in your foreheads. These last 153 days represent his 153 first fruits that were still alive in the flesh on his first fruit harvest last year. Like I said, the Most High's word testifies that he has sent me in the spirit of and in the prophecy of his servant Elijah. And again, he told Elijah to go with the third group of 51 men to tell Ahaziah face to face that he was going to die. At some point during these 51 days, his word declares that you are going to know that he has sent me, and you are going to know that he is Yahweh Elohim, the all-powerful, self-existing creator of all things, and the Holy One of those whom he rules over. When he uncovers my arm, you are going to find out that my arm is not my arm, but rather it is his arm. He is going to fight for me and do the slaying. He is going to fight for me because he rules over me. His word tells us in Jeremiah chapter 17 that cursed is the man that makes his flesh his arm. And he will fight for you if you will turn to letting him rule over you. His word is going to judge you. Today, Yahweh Elohim is telling you that the 1973 Arab-Israeli war was just a small foreshadow of the coming war. Here is a quote from Wikipedia concerning this war. Both the United States and the Soviet Union initiated massive resupply efforts to their respective allies during the war, and this led to a near confrontation between the two nuclear superpowers. Do you think that it is a coincidence that the Most High has led me to say that he is going to empower a coalition of nations that includes Russia to come against the scattered nations of Israel, especially the United States, in the coming days? Go ahead and think so. Verse 7 of his Ezekiel chapter 4 prophecy also says, "Thus you shall make ready for or prepare for the siege of Jerusalem before your face." Through the testimony of the Most High's word that he has sent me to you with, he has revealed that many of the prophecies that are recorded for Jerusalem at the time of the end are referring to the United States. He has done so in a precept upon precept, measuring line upon measuring line, here a little, there a little way. Yet, in the last video, he led me to speak that the physical city of Jerusalem is not going to be left out of this war. On the contrary, the Yom Kippur war shows that they are going to be a catalyst for it. And this is happening. The nations are being gathered into battle at this time, and they have been for some time now. This war will begin in the east, and it will be brought upon the west. There are prophecies that are against the actual city of Jerusalem at the time of the end as well. Like the Most High just told you through his servant, Dan will be recompensed as well. It is just that the actual city of Jerusalem is not going to be completely destroyed like the United States will be. It is not going to be utterly destroyed because he is going to return a people there and set up his throne through his only begotten son and his first fruits from there. Yahweh spoke through his servants, the prophets, that he is going to show his arm to the descendants of Israel who will return to his rule and to the rest of the world who will come under his rule by turning back those nations whom he has empowered to come against Israel. He is going to humble you to get a remnant of you to turn back to letting him rule over you to truly become Israel, to truly become his people. And then he is going to once again fight for those of you who will come under his rule. He is going to uncover his mighty arm and once again fight for Israel. The fact that the war lasted for 19 days is significant in this as well. When Yahweh altered the rotations of the luminaries during the days of Hezekiah, he did so in a way that altered the rotations of the moon into a 19-year cycle. Each 19 years, the moon's rotations returned to the same place that it was 19 years prior. The reason why this is significant is the Most High has restored his 30-day months, but he has not yet returned the cycle of the moon to reflect its 30-day cycle. On June 20th of 2012, the day after the Most High spit me out of the belly of the giant ocean-traversing plane back here in the chief seat of the scattered descendants of Israel, he revealed that he had restored his 30-day months. He returned me here 30 days prior to his first fruit harvest that was on July 19th on the calendar that Satan's children use. He has not yet returned the rotations of his luminaries to reflect this restoration by design. He has done so to testify to part of his witness against the children of Israel. The reason why he has not yet returned the cycle of the moon to the 30-day rotation is found in the testimony of his word. It starts with the reason why he altered them in the first place. He altered them because Hezekiah did not believe his word that he spoke through his servant Isaiah, and he required a physical sign. Yeshua told us that at the time of the judgment, there would be no other sign given except for the sign of Jonas. And when he said this, he said that a wicked and an adulterous generation seeks after a sign. He was referring to those of you who seek after a different sign other than that which Yahweh's word testifies to. You have proven that a physical sign other than Yahweh's wrath will not be enough for you anyway. And sadly, even his wrath will only motivate a small remnant of you to return to him. You believe the physical sign of Yeshua being raised up on the third day, yet you still will not hearken to that which both he and his father told you to do. By not returning the cycle to its 30-day rotation, Yahweh is illustrating the judgment of his word that he has spoken through his servants, the prophets. Yeshua's 3 days and three nights in the tomb set up the sign of Jonas. The three different tiers of this sign testify that the Most High has restored his 30-day months. He set it up this way in order to stamp his judgment on those of you who do not believe his word that he has spoken through his servants, the prophets, and require a physical sign. Yeshua gave us many signs that he was Yahweh's only begotten son and our Messiah. So when he said that no other sign would be given except for the sign of Jonas, he was referring to a sign that is for something specific. The same is true with the second witness. Yahweh's word gives us several signs that testify to his second witness, like his Ezekiel 24 sign that is his promise that he has sent me to you. Therefore, the sign of Jonas is a sign that was to accompany the time of the judgment is for something specific. It is not a sign that was going to identify Yeshua or the second witness, but rather it was going to testify to a specific event. And this event is the restoration of our Creator's 30-day months, and therefore the restored timing of his appointed times, including his Sabbaths. He has funneled the day and the year of his wrath into the 7 days that are between the first day and the eighth day of the 11th month on his restored calendar. This period of time will be between the 13th and the 20th of January 2014 on Satan's calendar. The 40 days of this prophecy end on the first day of the 11th month, the beginning of these 7 days. Return to that which the Most High has restored and prepare to meet your Maker by letting him rule over you so that he will uncover his arm to you. Otherwise, prepare to meet him through his hot indignation for your refusal to do so. Thus saith Yahweh Elohim.